Okay, so welcome to this talk about the enhanced script API. My name is Axel Faust. I'm working with Prodyna AG. This is an Alfresco partner, gold partner in Germany. We actually have a sponsor booth at the exhibition hall, so feel free to drop by. We have a couple of extension modules available for enterprise customers as well as community users that provide missing functionality, for example, like the faceted search that John Newton talked about yesterday. This talk is going to be about the enhanced script API, especially about the features of dynamic importing and batch processing in JavaScript. The presentation is based on the enhanced script environment, which is a project, open source project I set up on GitHub, which you can check out to follow the different functionality and to try it out for yourself. This enhanced script environment comes as add-ons for repository and share. There are actually two sets of add-ons, one set for the framework, which I'll be showing you in terms of the additional API, and one set of extensions and add-ons that provide patches to Alfresco that enable some of the functionalities in the use cases I'm going to be showing you in a couple of minutes. It works both on community and enterprise. I've used it myself for the last half year in all of our test environments, development environments, and it works fine so far, so it should be production ready. Unfortunately, up to now, I did not have a customer yet who wanted to use it in production, so I can actually claim it's safe to use it in production. It's using the Eclipse public license, so it's free to use in any other project, and you can make customizations to it yourself. Myself, I'm a Alfresco certified engineer as well as certified architect. As I said before, I'm working for Prodyna, which is a Alfresco Gold partner in Germany. The motivation for the enhanced script environment is as follows. The JavaScript functionality or the JavaScript runtime environment at Alfresco is pretty powerful. It is at the core of a lot of Alfresco community projects. I did a quick check yesterday and about one third of all the GitHub repositories that have been started at least once for Alfresco use JavaScript as a main programming language. So more than 50% line of code are attributed to JavaScript. Script developers are also quite ubiquitous. It's simple to learn to write a script for Alfresco, to create some extensions for Alfresco without having to dive into the complex Java world. And there's usually some web developer, some script developer in any company that is able to write new functionality for Alfresco based on JavaScript. And of course, as a dynamic language, it supports the development of rapid development of extensions, the agile development, without having to restart the entire Alfresco system over and over again for simple changes. You can develop in your environment, test it immediately, and make changes as necessary. But there are some pain points that triggered me to work on the enhanced Alfresco script environment. The main point I had was the limitations imposed by the way Alfresco imports or allows developers to import other scripts into a specific JavaScript. It's done by a preprocessor directive, the import directive, most of you might know, and it has some limitations both in terms of how the developer works with JavaScript in Alfresco as well as in terms of how someone might extend existing scripts. This tech actually makes JavaScript files in Alfresco invalid syntactically, and this disables a lot of functionalities, for example, code completion in IDEs as well as quality tools that evaluate the JavaScript and try to find out some bugs and hint the developers towards the bugs. And I created a Jira issue last year that already solved a lot of these issues by proposing a different type of import API for JavaScripts. This task has not yet been picked up or planned for any Alfresco release, and since it's already about 1.5 years old, it was quite too old for me to keep working on this with this patch myself in an unsupported way. I wanted to re-implement it in a sustainable, in an enhanced script environment with some additional functionality that I felt was missing in Alfresco projects based on our experience from customer projects. So I've started the Alfresco enhanced script environment in the fall and spring of this year. I already presented it in Germany, in Berlin at the meetup, and I've completed it for this presentation. And the following use cases are ones that often suffer from one or the other type of pain point in extending or customization of Alfresco. For example, if you want to add an additional document library filter to your document library for quick access to specific types of documents based on classification, based on the metadata state. It might prove difficult for someone new to Alfresco to actually see what he needs to adapt and to make all the changes necessary. To understand that, just a quick overview of the way the document library filters work in Alfresco. You have, on a share side, a web script called filter-get, which provides all the predefined filters for the Alfresco document library, both for the repository. There's a repo filter, get.js, as well as for the site-based document libraries. It's composed of configuration, HTML, as well as JavaScript that reads the configuration and provides the model for the FTL template that renders the HTML. This rendered HTML as well as its JavaScript code is then evaluated by the runtime JavaScript file, Alfresco.js, the core Alfresco file, and the document.less.js, which renders this list of file filters available to the end user. On the repository side, the actual evaluation of the filter occurs in the doc.less.get web script, which is the data web script for a document library. And this web script is not a simple web script. It is composed of several components that are contained in library JavaScript files, which are imported via the import statement. And at one time in that filters.lib.js, there's a simple switch state which goes through all of the predefined filters available in Alfresco to actually define the type of query used to retrieve documents for a specific filter, for a specific view. Now, the way this is set up makes it quite difficult to extend the document library with an additional filter for someone new to Alfresco or for someone who wants to provide an extension module, an add-on to Alfresco that does not interfere with any customer customizations. If you want to customize the document library filter, the first thing you can do or you have to do is to modify the filter web script on the share side to add your additional filter. Starting with Alfresco 4.0, you can do that with surf customization without impacting the original Alfresco source code file. So you don't have to make any changes through the original Alfresco file. You can just hook into your customization as a JavaScript post-processor, adjust the model that the filter get generates from the configuration, and add your own filter to the list of filters available. But of course, this is only just the UI configuration. As I said, this is pretty simple using the surf customization techniques. It gets a little bit more trickier on the repository tier. If you look at the way the document list web script includes the filter, it's via the import directive I talked about earlier, which is a directive that includes a specific script into the document list web script. And if you look at the path, it's pretty hard-coded to a class path within the Alfresco web application. So if you want to use the standard approach of customizing a web script in Alfresco, you would have to write a new filters.lib.js in the Alfresco extension directory. And because of the hard path set here in the import statement, you would also have to adjust the document library script itself. Even if you don't want to make any substantial or any semantical changes to it, you just have to override it due to the change of the URL for the importing. Or you can also modify the files directly in a web application, but this is of course deprecated in terms of stability for version upgrades. And the only change you wanted to make actually was adding this specific case, which adds another type of query to the evaluation of the document library web script. So you have to change a lot of files, both on the share side as well as on the repository side, just to add another filter. And it's not extensible at all because only one file can replace or override this filters.lib.js or this document list get.js. There's no way for customization for an add-on provided by the community to add filters to Alfresco, to the document library, without overriding any customizations made by a customer or having to deal with a kind of ordering issue, which file gets installed first and overrides the pre-existing files. Now, this is a serious problem we faced in several customer projects, and one of the most common problems in extending Alfresco, especially the share user interface with custom document library functionality. But there can also be issues in terms of dealing with scripts and workflows. For example, if you have a simple task, a simple script task in an activity workflow that might send out an email in an approval workflow about an update to a documentation For example, during an active approval workflow, the document might get updated once again due to some feedback from a reviewer, and that should trigger some notification to the next reviewer who is still due to perform his task. So this script task, for example, creates such a notification email, fills a template model, and generates the email, sends it out. Now, if we deploy that web script, this workflow script to Alfresco, it's contained in the XML description of the workflow of the process definition, and it's saved to the database, to the activity data tables in our database management system. If we have an evolution of this workflow, we have several versions of these of this workflow definition contained in the Alfresco database, and this is the source for every execution of the script where the source code is retrieved from. It does not matter what you have on the class path, what you have deployed in your server, it always reads the JavaScript code from these persisted workflow definitions. Now, let's say we don't have a semantical evaluation of a workflow, for example, a new functionality within a workflow, but you want to use additional functionality made available by an Alfresco version update and want to apply this functionality to all the workflows as well without having to go into the database and modifying the source code that's maintained, that's stored there. For example, in Alfresco 4.2, there's the new feature that you can provide a message key as a subject of the email action to have the email automatically use a localized subject message for the generated email, which was not possible before. So, for example, in this instance, we might want to replace this hard-coded subject with a message key for all existing workflows, for all previous workflow versions, to send out a localized message, localized subject to the recipients. But how would we customize the existing workflow in the database without having to modify the database itself? And unfortunately, it's not even stored in plain text. It's stored in a binary format, which makes it pretty much impossible to modify it after the fact you've installed the workflow. So this is another pain point, a maintainability pain point that's due to the way scripts are handled in Alfresco. And another issue that's not my original motivation, but which occurred to me later, is the issue of mass updates to existing contents. For example, if you have a large result set returned from Solr and you want to process that resource set with a specific type of logic, and that logic is quite complex, you don't want to process each result in turn after one another. You want to do it in parallel to save execution time to speed up your process. For this instance, an example, we have a site, and that site might need to be archived, might need to be made read-only, still existing in the Alfresco repository, but all permissions or state change in such a way that it's not usable by the end users or modifiable anymore. So we have different kinds of activities that need to be performed, for example, changing the permissions, changing the ownership of the documents, as well as stopping any workflows that might be executing at the moment and might include some automatic modification of the content within the site. Now, it's pretty simple for a site that only has about 100 or a couple of hundred items, but if you have a large site, especially in the large organizations, you end up in a situation where either the duration is not acceptable anymore, or you fail due to some intermittent failures on some specific nodes where there's an invalid state, where your logic fails. And if your script fails in the middle of a run of about 1 million files, we have to start all over again, which makes it pretty much useless in a production environment. So these are three use cases to demonstrate how the enhanced script environment may help to improve working with JavaScript files in Alfresco. In the first part, I want to focus on the dynamic importing in order to support additional ways to combine scripts, to redo scripts, without having to rely on the existing import statements of Alfresco. By the way, the current way Alfresco handles imports is one of the oldest parts of the application. I think it dates back as far as Alfresco 2.1, so it hasn't been revised since then. For reference, if you include a script in another Alfresco Java script, what Alfresco does before it executes that script A, it merges these scripts into one new script file and then compiles it. It's a preprocessor, and it basically merge them in the order they've been declared. And you can only define imports on the top of your script file. You cannot define it anywhere within your script file. So you always have the order in which they have been defined, B, C, A. So any logic in B is executed before C, before A, and you have no control over the content and the logic of that web script, of that script you're importing. In contrast to that, it's one animation, the enhanced script environment adds a new way to import scripts, which first of all allows you to import scripts using a JavaScript function instead of a preprocessor. So basically, if when Alfresco executes the script that uses the enhanced script environment, it directly executes script A and only at the points where we actually use the new API, the JavaScript function that imports a specific script, it delegates the execution to that script. It imports it in the current context. It may be a function where you call this importing function. It may be a for loop where you include a certain script multiple times. It includes it inline, executes it in the current context with all environment variables intact at that point in time. So you can basically do any kind of processing before, between, afterwards, and you can even have conditional imports using if switch case block, for example, for selecting a specific script to execute. And you don't even need to know the script in advance before writing your file or when writing your file. You can even have dynamic imports based on the import of a user, just passing on some value that you've retrieved or that you've been passed by a parameter in a web script. So the API that enables this is the JavaScript API at the top of the three import directives, which provide different options to achieve different results in terms of importing. There's a simple importer, where you basically just state the location of the script to be imported and the type of locator for that script to resolve that location to a script file. For example, all of the classical importer types like class path, like store path in a serve environment are supported here. But there are also some additional variants of that method that allow you to pass some additional parameters, for example, if the import should fail with an exception if the script file could not be located. So you can even have some kind of optional lookups where you try to import a file and react to its presence or absence based on the return value of that method, which always returns true or false depending if the script could be imported and executed or if it wasn't. And you can also have some, can also provide some parameters to the import. For example, for a locator, which is able to use additional information to dynamically look up a script, for example, in a remote system or anywhere else, any kind of logic you might think of to be used as a resolution. The actual locators are implemented as Java objects provided by this interface. And you see here a parameter on the Java side, which is not available in the script API. It's a reference script. The current script being executed can be used as a reference for any location, for any imports, and can allow you to resolve scripts relatively. For example, if you have a class path script, you can do relative lookups. If you have an XPath, if you have another kind of path that supports relative locations to be specified, it can resolve it based on the current script being executed, which is made available to the locator on the Java side. And basically, what the script environment does once it's been installed in Alfresco system, it automatically changes, transparent to the end user, all of the existing import statements through the corresponding script API calls. So if you install the script environment into your Alfresco system, all import statements are no longer merged and are automatically switched to that way of importing scripts by the script processor in use. So for example, the corresponding API call for the previous import tag is now import script, class path, and then the path that you want to resolve to, or a relative path. The script environment comes with some predefined locator types. As I said before, the original or the previous standard script import methods are all supported. For example, for both repository and share, you can use class path as script locator. You can use xpath noteref on the repository side. Legacy is actually the way Alfresco used to import any resources on the repository side if you didn't prefix it with class path. So it has a switch of in it depending on if you start with a slash. So the original implementation, the original logic is maintained by the legacy locator. And in share and serve, you have the store path that is able to retrieve scripts from the serve stores, and this can even be remote locations, for example, your repository, just like your Dashlet configuration, which are saved into the repository. You can also have scripts available in the repository and look them up by an abstract path via the serve search paths. There are some additional, or at least one additional importer, which is not available in standard Alfresco. It's a registry, which allows you to register specific scripts just by using an abstract name without having to care where it's actually located. Some functionality, some configuration says there's a script, it should be available via this short name, this string, and any script can look up that script without having to know if it's a class path, if it's on the repository side, or if it's anywhere remotely. So how should would this look in an example? For example, this would be an advanced usage of the script import API for the registry. And in this instance, it's using an optional condition. This is the resolution parameters in the API. And that parameters, for example, defines a chain of conditions to apply. And one would be a condition where we pass a version to the import script. And this, the registry supports versioned JavaScript as well, so you can even look up JavaScript files depending on a specific version, for example, a version of a workflow, a version of an API you want to provide, and you can register JavaScript files with a version, with an upper and lower limit, for example, of applicability. You can specify if it applies to community or to enterprise, so you can have kind of a dynamic add-on that reacts to the actual Alfresco instance that you've provided the script to based on the version of the Alfresco system and the edition of the Alfresco system. And in this instance, this is a lookup of a doclist get JavaScript file, so the doclist get JS in effect, and it looks it up not just in a global registry, but the registry also supports so-called sub-registries where you can have a grouping of scripts available in a container. For example, the container would be the document library v2 container for all scripts related to the document library in the implementation starting with Alfresco 4.0. And the condition, of course, is a selective import condition for a specific version of Alfresco. There's also an additional advanced usage. The last parameter in the last variant of the script import API defines a scope that you can pass to the import. And this allows you to define the execution context of the imported script and restrict any access to variables to that context that you've provided. So if you import a script which is potentially unsafe, unsecure, you don't know what it does, you can provide it with a predefined context, only passing the information that you actually require the imported script to receive. And you can also predefine properties that can be used to transport results back to the caller that you can extract from the scope that you've passed. So this allows you to execute scripts in a secure manner, independent of how secure your script is. For instance, if you don't know what extensions others might provide to your module, to your application that you're writing on a Fresco. And since you can pass anything that's representable in JavaScript, in the object model of JavaScript, you can also pass back functions, callback functions from the imported script to be used by the importer later on in the execution of its logic to call back for specific use cases, for specific requests. How would this look for the document library filters? If you apply the script environment and want to enhance a document library with an additional filter based on that environment, the customization on the share side stays the same. It's already pretty extensible using the serve extension functionality. But on the repository side, if you install the set of patch modules that I provide with the environment, you're able, or the patch module change the way the filter script looks up the actual filters by looking up the filter in a registry based on the name of the filter. So you have a configuration on the share tier where you say this filter has a specific ID, and that ID is passed to the repository and then used to look up a small script file that you can provide that actually implements your filter logic. And all of the other things are just overhead housekeeping for the filter script to import your script that you can provide. It provides you with an isolated context where you have access to all the parameters of the call, and where you can return your results, for example, your query, your search query that you want to use, your search language that you want to use, and any kind of sorting, for example. And any additional filter might be as simple as providing a specific script. It must not be that complex as it's here, as it's displayed here. I've implemented a script which is just two or three lines, and most of the standard Alfresco filter scripts are not more than four lines in total for defining the query to be used. And this can be put into a specific extension path, which is a new path that Alfresco looks up for any extensions to the script registry. And it's possible to use it in extension as well as in any add-on modules. For example, in the Alfresco module and then the module ID, there's also a lookup path for these register scripts. And then you have the name of the actual registry that you do want to use. And the name of your filter would be myfilter.js, and its ID would be myfilter, so it would locate it based on the registration. This path is evaluated by a scanner when you start up your Alfresco system, and it automatically registers any JavaScript files it finds here into the Alfresco runtime. And it even supports the ability to define versions that this script should apply to by using any path below that root point. So you can have subpaths that state this script in this path is only valid for Alfresco version 4.1 to 4.2, for example, or just available for community or enterprise. If you have a look at the environment tool in the GitHub repository, you will see some examples on the patch projects for the existing Alfresco filters that are common to Alfresco 4.0 up to 4.2D. These are the filters I have currently transferred, re-implemented based on this framework. And also, you can do the same for workflow. For example, if you have an activity workflow, and have a script included in a script task in activity workflow, you can do this by using an import, and you can base the import on a version, and that version may be mixed into the XML of the workflow definition by your build tool, for example, Maven. You can import, you can include the version of your project using Maven placeholders into the source code of your workflow script in your XML, and that allows you to load a specific script on runtime for that version of the module that you've originally deployed the script for. But it may also allow you, if you define upper and lower ranges of version ranges, to provide new scripts later on in patch projects to that workflow that alter the way the original script work because the latest version within a version range is automatically used to execute that script that you're trying to import. Okay, any questions so far before I go on to the next topic of batch processing, just to make sure that everyone is on page? Yep.
How about logging and line numbers?
I've also added an additional login functionality. So the question was, what about logging and line numbers in the log information? I've added some extended logging functionality as well in the script environment, which makes it possible to define a specific logger for each script so that you don't have to write to the same logger for all scripts. For example, this org alfresco JScript script logger, which is the standard logger, you can define a logger to be used for that script specifically as the first operation in your script, and all output you log will be put into to a specific log4j logger. Unfortunately, there's nothing in terms of line numbers because it depends on how the script is actually compiled and evaluated at runtime if this information is actually available. So this is something I don't yet support, or this project does not yet support, but I hope it will be made available in future versions. But you can have separate logging for separate files, which makes it simpler to track down issues with specific JavaScript files. And it works with the import API as well as the standard Alfresco. Okay, the second part of the talk is about batch processing in JavaScript. As long as there are no additional questions at the moment, we have a section later on for closing questions. Batch processing is the second part of the talk, providing an API that allows you to process a large amount of data concurrently within a JavaScript without having to resort to the Alfresco Java API for batch processing. Now, Alfresco already provides a batch processing API on Java, and it's more or less complex depending on how you look at it and how much experience you got with Java and concurrent execution of logic in Java. Basically what we have is an environment where we have a so-called batch processor, and clients can provide a certain implementation of a work provider as well as a batch worker to provide both the items that the batch processor should work on as well as the individual logic that should be executed on each item of a specific set of items. And internally, we have a batch processor which delegates the different executions to a thread factory to start concurrent execution, and each of these threads then call a specific transaction in which they execute the provider that you've passed as a parameter to perform the actual processing of the logic of your batch process. This is available in Java and is the core of any concurrent batch processing in Alfresco standard. But it's unfortunately not available in JavaScript at the moment, except if you use the Rhino JavaScript binding and access a JavaScript class directly from your Rhino context using the packages org Alfresco prefixes, which is quite a hassle, quite difficult to do, and is pretty much verbose, makes the code unreadable in effect, and possibly unmaintainable if the classes of Alfresco change. Now, the setup is, as I said before, that you have a work provider that retrieves or determines the next batch of work. Batches are created for the thread factory, scheduled as a callback, and the execution is in parallel based on the threads created by the thread factory to the configured amount of parallel workers. And you have callbacks both for, for the three phases before batch, for every item of a batch, and after a certain batch has completed. And this is what I tried to expose and what I did expose on JavaScript using these various new functions available on the JavaScript API side. Basically, there are two ways of dealing with batch process, by providing a work processor or by providing the pre-calculated array of items, a collection of items, without having a callback functionality. So basically, we have three variants in two certain approaches. So for example, just providing the items, providing a callback to process each individual item, and configuring the amount of threads to execute the batch in, and the size of each batch, how the separation of the work items into batches should be dealt with. And there are some optional variants of the method that you can use to provide the before and after callbacks for the actual batches, for example, for setting up the environment for each individual batch. The execution is something, or the context of the execution of each callback is something that has to be kept in mind. It's the same as it is for the Alfresco Java batch processor API. Basically, it's actually built on top of that. So we are reusing existing Alfresco functionality on the Java side to surface that functionality on the JavaScript side. And there are different scopes for each of these callbacks. The work processor, or the work provider, is always executed in a same context that your client code is executed in. So if you call import script, but execute batch, the work provider is called in the context of your script that calls that method, while the before and after callbacks are not executed in any transaction context themselves. They have access to the context of the script environment since they can be provided as functions, as closures, for example, that have access to the surrounding variables, but they're not executed in any transactional context. So usually they're only there for setting up a specific context, retrieving some information, but not writing, changing some information. And the process item callback, this is called in the actual batch process context, which is isolated from the surrounding context and has its own transactional runtime. And how would such a callback look like? There's two ways you can provide this callback. One is by a simple callback function, just using an anonymous function or some function you defined anywhere in your script file that you've imported from somewhere and pass it as a parameter. Of course, the process item callback has one argument, that's the item to be processed, but all other callbacks don't have any kind of arguments. You can also use the same kind of callback definition as you use for extending, for example, YUI components for the event handling in the client-side JavaScript, by providing a scope object that defines the context of the process callback in which it should be executed. For example, for predefining some information that should be available to that callback function. And each process item callback has also an implicit batch context where it can store local variables without having to store it in the outer context, without having to care about concurrent access to the same set of data. This is how a simple batch might look in JavaScript. This is something I created in the admin console, the JavaScript console written by Florian Maul. It's basically a processor that cleans the user home folders for every user in Alfresco, and it processes these in batches based on the initials of the username for defining the different work items, and then processes a certain amount of users. I think I've configured it to 5 users per batch to clear the user home folder of any type of content located therein. And basically what we have here is a simple callback object or callback with a scope for the work processor. And this has some specific scope elements, for example, the current initial or the last initial and the maximum char code of an initial. So it goes from A to Z in several invocations, in several iterations of retrieving new work items. So it does not have to retrieve all users in one operation. It can separate the work partition the data it provides to the process callback. So the first batch process can actually start before all of the people have been loaded into the script. And the actual processor is just a simple script passed as a parameter, which uses the provided person, looks up the home folder of that person, and clears it of any context, of any information. And we're doing it for up to 4 parallel batch processors, so 4 parallel threads. Each of 5 batch items, it's been executed. And we even have a before process template. This is actually another use case I use for an example. It's not clearing, it's recreating a home folder based on a template. This was an example I used in another presentation. So basically we have a before process template here that looks up a specific structure template in the data dictionary, and instead of clearing the context, as I erroneously said, it actually creates a user home folder based on a specific template file, a template structure. Since it's JavaScript, we have a couple of issues to consider regarding parallel execution, scope handling, and synchronization of data structures, concurrent access to data structures. JavaScript, as well as the Rhino implementation of JavaScript, are inherently not thread safe. They are not safe for parallel execution over the same context information, over the same sets of data. So we have to consider concurrent access as potentially dangerous, since it can modify specific sets of data while another executor, another batch, is working on them. In order to provide a pretty decent default in terms of synchronization in protecting against these types of issues, I've provided guards in the batch processing API, both in terms of the local scope that each batch inherently has. So every variable that you define within your batch is stored locally, and it's free of any chance of any danger of concurrent access because only the current batch has access to it, as well as some read-write synchronization on access information in a shared scope. So if you pass, if you access some variable from outside of your callback function, this is on the context that you've defined in your client script, and every access to variables in that context is automatically synchronized via read-write depending on the action you're taking. Reads are, of course, read-synchronized, writes are write-synchronized, so no one else can do any modifications on it, and even functions are synchronized, since not all of the Alfresco JavaScript API extensions are inherently thread safe. For example, the script node is not thread safe. You can't work on the same script node in different threads. Access to the methods provided by these objects is also synchronized on invocation. The type of synchronization is handled based on the name of the function. So I have some defaults in there based on names and name patterns. For example, every get is of course only read synchronized, so multiple batches can read the same set of data or execute the same of read same read-only function. But some methods are inherently write. For example, every setter is executed exclusively for the specific processor that calls it. Last slides are about the details and some miscellaneous information about the implementation of the script environment, how it's built up, and what I see for future features on the roadmap for the script environment at the moment. The way Alfresco can be extended in terms of the JavaScript API as it is in the current Alfresco releases is by providing the ability to implement processor extensions on the Java side that are hooked into a specific processor. This can be a script processor, but it can also be a template processor for FreeMarker. And these extensions are made available with a predefined name from the configuration in your JavaScript runtime. These are usually high-level business enhancements or business APIs that are provided in this way. They are mostly agnostic of the actual script context. They don't use specific Rhino functionality, except perhaps in converting parameters and results back to the script environment. So they're Rhino agnostic and business oriented. And every script processor, for example, the Rhino script processor on the repository side, as well as a JavaScript processor on the serve side, implement an interface from the processor, so they inherit the processor extensions automatically. This way of extending the API was actually not suitable for me to provide the import function, the import API and the batch processing, because I needed deeper access to the Rhino context, to the Rhino execution runtime to do my magic or do the script importing. So on top of that, or in addition to that, there's a new interface defined by the script environment, which is called Enhanced Script Processor, and it defines a method of extending the low-level API via so-called interface scope contributor, which is intended to be able to provide low-level APIs, for example, JavaScript functions, JavaScript native objects, to extend the Rhino API. And I've re-implemented or partially re-implemented all existing script processors using this new interface and providing the additional functionality of the enhanced script environment. Other features I've included into the script runtime at the moment is some enhanced logging. I've replaced the existing logger with a new implementation that allows custom loggers per script, logger inheritance over imported scripts, for example, as well as parameterized logging logging with information from the runtime. So we don't have to concatenate the strings before you log them. And there's also some debugging support. Support for Eclipse JSDT is enabled, so we can have remote debugging of JavaScript on the repository without having the Rhino debugger from a remote system from your client workstation. And there's also version information. You've seen in one of the examples that I've used version information to look up a script. These are provided both in repository and in share and are based on the currently installed Alfresco version. So you always have the repository information available in these contents for version lookups. Enhancements, possible future features are as follows. For example, value type handling, which might be improved, for example, dealing with Java strings versus JavaScript strings, where there's a bit of incompatibility depending on how the value is passed. Clean proper surfacing of sensitive APIs, for example, auditing and policies, which can be dangerous if used improperly, as well as authentication and tenancy. And some proof of concepts I want to do attempt, for example, integrating Nashorn as the JavaScript runtime in Alfresco for upcoming Java 8 JDKs. I hope to be able to do this during the break in the winter, but this is something I would like to do in the near future. Again, if you want to try it out yourself, the code can be found on GitHub in my personal repository, Alfresco Enhanced Script Environment. Both the framework as well as the patch files necessary to enable the document library filter extension. And if you're using the JavaScript console, the current version of that enhancement of the environment is compatible with JavaScript console 1.6.0. It's not compatible with earlier versions due to a hard dependency on the previous Rhino script processor in the Alfresco repository. So thank you for listening. If there are any questions at the moment. If not, I'll be at our sponsor booth in the exhibition hall. You are free to come up to me anytime you want. I'll be here the entire conference. And thanks for listening, and hope you'll try out and enjoy the JavaScript enhanced environment. Thank you.